2021, and we are in the month of June, and today is the 13th precisely. Hallelujah. We bless God for our lives, what He's doing in our lives, what He's doing through us, how He's touching other people through us. And we bless Him for giving us the privilege to be His workers, to be His partners. Hallelujah. Okay, we welcome viewers across the nations. This is Literary House International Church, all the way from the USA, coming to you live via Facebook and YouTube. In case you miss any portion of this broadcast, please go to our webpage, libertyhouseusa.org. Once again, libertyhouseusa.org, or go to our YouTube page. Type in the church's name, and then there you are with all the truths. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right, yours truly, I'm a messenger of the Lord Jesus Christ, an agent of change and transformation, and always because God is transforming us from what? Faith to faith and glory to glory. When He sends me to you, He sends me with the message of transformation. So be ready, be alert. Hallelujah. I'm not here to put you down. I'm not here to be condescending, to degrade you, to get you angry or offended. No, that's not my mission. My mission is to partner with you to experience the goodness of God.
Hallelujah.
And to realize all that God has for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Okay, so let's take this trip together. Glory to God.
Amen.
Now let's turn our Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 15. We are going to take it from the 24th verse. Did I have it right? Wait a second. No, 21. I'm sorry, 21. Matthew 15 from 21. Hallelujah. So Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. Let's read on. We are reading all the way down. And behold, a woman of Caesarea came from that region and cried unto him. So people read things like this, cry. So they take it to be like, okay, I'm going before God. I'm going to cry. Today God is going to see my tears. I'll cry. God can't do anything but what? To move on my behalf.
Mm-hmm.
Crying stands for what? Calling on God, asking God, requesting God to do something. So cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord. Son of David, my daughter is severely demon possessed. She had a situation. Say situation. I don't know what situation you have, but there's nothing too big for God. There's nothing too hard for God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I said there's nothing too hard or difficult for God. Do you know that the answer to what you're looking at, the way out, is within you? No, you didn't believe that. I didn't hear a big amen. That means you're asking yourself the question, what is within me? Where is it? How come I'm not aware of it? I said, the way out, whatever you are looking at, whatever situation you are facing, the way out is within you. Now, let me break it down for those who probably may be wondering. The Holy Spirit is God within you. The Holy Spirit resides, indwells you. The Holy Spirit knows everything, just like God knows everything, and Jesus knows everything. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the way out is in you. Because He guides you into all what? Truth. That includes the way out. Whatever you are facing, it's no surprise. Whatever you are going through, it's no strange thing to Him. He saw it before He showed up. And He knows exactly what help He has offered you so you can overcome that challenge.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You see, at this time, Jesus had not died. He had not given up His life. So she cried unto Him, help me. For what? My daughter is severely demon possessed. But He answered her not a word. Who said Jesus is me? Savior, right? He's a Messiah. He can do all things. He heals the sick. He raises the dead. Makes the cripple walk. Now this woman comes to her and says, help me out. And he acted as though he didn't even hear what she said. You may be in that place today. You may be in that place now as I'm speaking to you, as you hear my voice, or whatever time you are going to listen to this message. You may be in that place where it seems as though God is silent. I've been told all my life, you will say. I mean, God hears our prayers. God answers our prayer. But I prayed, not once, not twice, not thrice. More than that, what's going on? I don't see any change. Relax. Be still and know. What?
Amen.
He's God.
Amen.
He's still God. He hasn't changed.
Hallelujah.
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 The woman was relaxed. She was still. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He answered her not a word. And look at the disciples. The disciples came and urged him, saying, Master, send her away. Look at that. For what? She cries out after us. Some believers, that's where they are. This lady, I don't want to pick your call. This brother, no, anytime he comes around, no, I don't even want to. They are always talking about their problems. They are always asking for help. Have you heard that before? Anytime somebody comes around you and you realize that in their talk, they may not be direct. Some are indirect, but some too are direct. Whichever way, direct or indirect. And then you realize that there's some manifestation or what you are saying, expression of what? Helplessness. Can you say helplessness?
Helplessness.
Hopelessness. Go ahead.
Hopelessness.
You realize that there's discouragement in what you are saying. There's some kind of confusion. That is the time. They feel low. They feel down. That is the time you have to what? Master faith. Step out. Be bold. Audacious. And say truth to them. Say the word. Preach to them. Believe the Holy Spirit to work through you, to work with you, to touch their lives.
Amen.
They are not talking to you by accident. It's a divine word, appointment. God has chosen you for that moment to help them out. Hallelujah. I heard you said, Pastor, me, myself, I'm thinking about my own problems. That's the problem. You are thinking about your own problems? Let your mind be stayed on God, not your problem. Tell you someone, tell the person, let your mind be stayed on God, not your problems. That's a discipline that we must all work in. Our minds focused on God, not the problem. Some people are losing sleep. You know that? They don't sleep. They are in bed, but they are not sleeping. Why? Because the problem is sleeping, and they are rather awake. The problem is relaxed, and they are rather awake. No! And then we sing songs like, he's the burden bearer. You are bearing the burden. What are you doing bearing the burden? Give it to the burden bearer.
Amen.
You know the word. Roll your care unto him. Then that's done by faith. And still you walk in faith. The moment you roll it, who has it? If you are carrying a load and somebody comes along to help you and you give the person the load, do you have the load or the person who is helping you? Jesus said, whatsoever things you desire, Mark 11:24, whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe that you have received them, and you shall have them.
Yes.
Discipline. Faith. The moment you pray, know that God heard you. Probably you are expecting instantaneously. I know that time the microwave is not quick enough. It takes some seconds. instantaneously. That may not happen, but that doesn't mean God has not heard you. That's why it says, believe that you have received, and you shall. You shall receive. So between you have received and you have received and you shall what? Am I saying it right? Believe the moment you pray, what right things you desire, believe that you have received, and then. No, the way you are saying it, please, we'll come back to this. What? Well, where are we? Okay, oh, is it? Is there? Oh, you guys, I didn't look at it. You should have told me that. Okay, let's not read that. Read. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask, the ask is desire, is the same. Okay, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and then you will have. Put the old King James there, because I think the old King James is. Who said the old King James is messing with my mind? Therefore, I say to you, whatsoever things, you see the desire there? Whatsoever. Okay. What things soever you desire. When you pray, believe that you have received them, and you shall have them. So instantaneously, the moment you open your mouth, because he knows even what you have need of, according to Matthew 6:8, before you even ask him. And whatever you are going to say, he knows it. But because of his system, he has to wait for you to finish it. He wants to see the expression of your faith, your trust towards him. The moment he sees that, it is done. It's released. Now, people have twisted what they've read in Daniel, but I'll use it and you see how it works. He told Daniel that the very first day, you remember this story, right? The very first day you ask, what happened? Huh? I answered your prayer the very first day. Then, what they major on is the fact that, oh, the prince of Persia intercepted the answer. And Daniel didn't know. So he kept what? Praying and asking and asking. And that's what some children do, children of God do now. They keep asking and asking. And God is saying, no, I've answered you. Open your eyes. Stop asking. Thank me because I've given it to you. Then someone will say, but where is it? I don't see it. We can see things or we can be aware of things with our physical senses. At the same time, we can be aware of things and see things and know things by our spiritual senses. And that training, a lot of believers don't have that. And that is where the problem is. That's where faith comes in. When he says, when you pray, what's the right things you desire when you pray? Believe you have received them and you shall have them. Faith tells you that, okay, I have it. Like David. He knew God had given him victory over Goliath. I'll say that again. He knew God had given him what? Victory over Goliath. When he said, I'm going to chop off your head, he saw it. Faith always sees the finished work.
Amen.
He sees the result. And that's why faith. When you walk in faith, you're able to rejoice, you're able to celebrate, you're able to give glory to God like Abraham did. Strong in faith was giving glory to God. That's what we need to do. Praising God and thanking Him for what our eyes are about to see in the natural. Hallelujah. So that's what it is. So between you receive, know that you have received. Not going to win. Leave that alone. Just thinking. Your timetable may be different. It's always different from his timetable. Unless you lock arms with him. Unless you come into alignment and there's a knowing of his timetable, then you are good. Hallelujah. Okay, let's go back to what we were reading. New King James, the Syrophoenician woman. Mark. The same thing is in Mark, anyway, chapter 7. So Matthew chapter 15, where do we get to? What verse? 24? Okay, let's vote. Okay, so we got to 23. Let's read 23 one more time before we shift to 24. But he answered her not a word, and his disciples came and urged him, saying, send her away, for she cries out after us. You know that some people can be annoying? They are pain in the neck. At times, I want you to understand this. They are going through something. So bear with them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm going to repeat that. When you say amen, I'll move on. And then I'm going to sound like a broken record. I said some people can be a pain in the neck. But bear with them. Because at times they are going through something.
Amen.
The amen is weak. Some people are a pain in the neck. But bear with them. Because most of the time they are going through something.
Amen.
One more time. Some people are a pain in the neck. Very, very annoying. But bear with them because they might be going through something.
Amen.
That's better. Hallelujah. It's true. See, at times, some people, they are not disciplined. They don't know what to do with their issues and their problems. And then they cave in. So they are walking and they are under the circumstance. So you may not have wronged them. You may not have said anything. Can you put this thing on 72, please? Easy. You may not have wronged them nothing, but what happens is this. They already, you know, stress out. And they take it out on you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Give them some room. Okay, let's go to the 24th verse now. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But he answered and said, I was not sent except the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Can you imagine it? It's like, I don't have time for you. I'm on my way out. I have some business to attend. You are not the reason why I'm here. That's what it sounds like. That's what it seems like. He answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now we'll go to the Mark account. So we understand what he's saying, but let's read on. Let's see what happened, whether Jesus ministered to her or not. Then she came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. No, let's stay there for a second. And let's read that together. Read. Then she came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. In the midst of crisis, in the midst of the storm, she wasn't complaining. What did she do? She worshiped.
Amen.
She worshiped. That's what you must do.
Amen.
That's the right posture.
Amen.
In the midst of what you call delay, hindrance, unless the Holy Spirit reveals to you, rebuke this, rebuke that, bind this, bind that, come against this, come against that. If he does it, and you know you're taking care of business, you worship, you prostrate before the Lord. This was before the Lord Jesus Christ himself. She came and worshiped. You know what? She could have picked a fight with the disciples. You guys, do you know what I'm going through? Instead of helping me, clearing the way for me to get to the master, look at what you're doing. Some people, you know, when they are going through, they pick up unnecessary fights. Because their trouble has them. She did it. This is focus. She had a desire, a godly desire. She was focused. Lord, help me. And that's what you have to do. Let's read on. Don't come to a place where you are so under your problem. Now, you lift your voice to sing. You used to sing, I worship you. I worship you. The reason I live is to worship you. Now, then you lift your voice. I worship. It's not coming. Oh, my God. I can't believe this. I worship. Then you begin to cry. No. You are bigger than the problem.
Amen.
And whatever demon spirit is behind you, you are bigger than that spirit. Don't give in. Don't allow yourself that way to be dominated. You should be dominating.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
When you think you feel low, that's the time you shout them all.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You begin to do things like that. Hallelujah. Hey, you are my dwelling place. That's what you do.
Hallelujah.
You don't go and sit in some kind of corner, then you palm your chin, and then I'm thinking. No. Open the book. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That talks about you and begin to read it aloud.
Amen.
That's what you do.
Amen.
You try that. Begin to read the book aloud and see if you even remember that there's a problem before you. The moment you open the book, the problem will run away. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But he answered and said, it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. Jesus said that it's not good. So he's saying, what you're asking for is like, doesn't belong to you. It belongs to the children. Who are the children? The lordship of Israel, the Jews. So I can't give that to you. Now you have to understand that the Jews referred to the Canaanites as dogs. That was what? Or whoever is not within the covenant of God, dog. But Jesus said, little dog. I think that is a term of endearment, like a puppy. So it's no insult. Let's read on. She wasn't bothered by all these things. Let's read on. But she said, yes, Lord, you are right. I agree with you. I love her attitude. Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. You see the persistence, the consistency, the patience. Can you say that after me? Persistence. Consistence. Patience. That's long suffering. She didn't give up. Wow. Let's hear Jesus' response. 28. We are still in Matthew 15. 28. Then Jesus answered and said to her, oh woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you, what? Let it be to you as? Let it be to you as? You desire. What desire do you have? Some desires, I don't think they will materialize. Or let me rephrase it. Some desires, God has nothing to do with that. God can work with you. Hallelujah. I'll tell you something that is strange. It's far. Many years ago, this happened in late 80s. A brother said God has spoken to him about a specific woman. Even though the woman was taken, the brother still believed that this is the woman God has given to me. Can you imagine? The woman was taken in a relationship. But still the brother was believing that this is it. So what do we say to that? He heard from the wrong source. Nathan, you're right. The wrong source. But at times, you know, people don't know that way. Why? Because probably it's their carnal nature. It's some lust and not a godly desire. Wow. Let it be to you as you desire. Desire is a very strong kind of thing. God works with desires. In Proverbs 10:24, the Bible says, the desire of the righteous shall be granted. The desire of the righteous. He will fulfill the desires of your heart. So when you come into communion with him, What is on him rubs off on you. You begin to know what he wants. You begin to know that God's heart desires. You begin to desire that. And then you begin to know what he desires for you. You begin to desire that and go into expectation.
Amen.
It makes things happen quicker than you think for you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And the daughter was what? Healed from that very hour. Wow. Jesus said to her, I'm taking from the top. Let's read. Read. Then Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. Isn't that amazing? She didn't have to waste money to go to another state, to go to another country. The daughter was not even present. She was home. That's why we say the word of God, the power of God, doesn't know time and distance. But if you don't get your training well, some people, that's what they say, things like, oh, if I can get this man to lay hands on me, if I can get this person. So I've seen this. I know what I'm talking about. Somebody may come forward to be ministered to, and they said, oh, go to Pastor so-and-so. To them, Pastor so-and-so, I want you to pray for me. Go to Pastor so-and-so. It's like, they don't have power. You have power. You have anointing. You see, you have believed in the wrong thing. And this goes on. Know this. No pastor owns the anointing. No pastor is the source of the anointing or the power of God. The power of God is from God himself. The pastor and any other person, they are vehicles, channels. The power of God flows. The anointing of God flows through them. That's it. And it flows through you too as well. Amen.
Amen.
Next verse. Then Jesus departed from there. And what? Skirted the sea of Galilee and went up on the mountains and sat down there. Mission accomplished. Hallelujah. What we have seen is a picture of what? Walking in faith. Walking in faith. Faith pleases God. According to Hebrews 11:6, without faith it is impossible to please God. Whoever comes to him must believe that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And we saw that diligence, the way she was seeking. And I think I've seen in the body of Christ some kind of ritual. They don't care. You know, it's just a matter of just, oh, I prayed. I've been praying. What are you praying about? I've just been praying. You know, as believers, we have to pray. You know, they don't even desire anything. And they don't even have any expectation. Let me slap you with some things here. This nation, this country, has a lot of things that must change. Or this country, this nation, the U.S., has a lot of things that we have to experience from God. Now, if you are not in alignment with God, you won't have any desire. You understand what I'm saying? And there's not going to be any expectation. But as you commune with God, you commune with the Holy Spirit, you study His Word, then you begin to desire what God desires for this country, what He has purpose to do with this country, and you begin to pray. You go into travail. When I say travail, you see, you become pregnant with these desires of God. You become pregnant with this will of God. You become pregnant with the purposes of God. And you begin to pray to see the manifestation of these things. So when you are praying, I'm telling you, some people, this is how they pray. You watch, I'm going to demonstrate it. They run around everywhere. They work even 16 hours. And then when they get home, they realize, I missed my quiet time. I said I was going to do it with my lunchtime. It didn't happen. But my lunchtime, this friend of mine came, his colleague at work was talking. I mean, the time left, I had to just eat my lunch and go back to work. You know, And then so I came home to, I had to pass the, you know, the store to grab this and come home and do this. So you come home like all your time is gone. Then you realize that last thing, you're about to sleep. And so I wouldn't pray. And then he said, oh, find the new ones. You think you are speaking in tongues. Then before you realize, you are even cursing. Because I know some people have done that before. I heard this myself. We're at an all-night prayer meeting many years ago. You know, mediators. And then this person were praying. He was seated, you know, and leaning against the wall. He had his head that way, up against the wall, and he was praying tongues, blah, 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 before we realized he was into the grocery list, talking about yams, potatoes, cassava, praying. He was gone. He was gone, but what? Unconsciously, he was saying those things. Seriously. It happened. I'm not telling you some whatever. Okay. Can I have a witness? Somebody who was, you know, you were really praying before you realized you're gone. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. No. You see, we have to come to a place of discipline. When you are going after it, you go after it with every fiber of your being, with such passion, with such tenacity, with such intentionality. That's how you do it.
Amen.
The woman was that way. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Yeah. You don't walk around and say, oh, I forgot even to pray. I don't even know what is going on. Mm-hmm. You have to know and begin to desire it and begin to expect it. Some of us, we are allowing ourselves to be robbed by the devil.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll share a secret with you. I've worked in this secret for years. It's also a prayer, but people don't pray that way. So I'll share this with you. Let's read the Ephesians chapter 5. 3:20, I'm sorry. Ephesians 3:20. God is able to do what? Exceeding Ephesians 3:20. Now, let's read. Now, to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Okay, hold it. So, God is able to do what? It's not like he's not able. He's able.
Yeah.
So if it's not happening, there must be something wrong. Okay. He's able to do exceedingly and abundantly. Those two words, they suggest that he does far over, more than, in excess, overflow. Do you get it?
Yeah.
God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. Because at times, before we ask, we don't know the full extent of what we even have to ask. Because God gives us a glimpse at times of what he wants us to do or where he wants us to go. Alright? We know by his word that this. So then we begin to ask. But it says that he's able to do far over what we ask. The secret I want to share with you is this. Or think. You see the word think? It means imagine. Think. Imagine. So it's not just what you even ask from God, but what you want. Think. Imagine. What you imagine. And counseling people are realizing. People at times they pray rightly. They use the right phraseology, right words. But the moment they say, in the name of Jesus, amen, the thinking is contrary to all that they have prayed about. They go back, they think the problem. Instead of thinking the solution or what they desire to see. You get what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Come on, you get what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Yeah. So you think your what? The results. Your desire. Your expectation. That's what you begin to think about.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So you see yourself, you know, possessing, working, experiencing whatever you are believing God for. And the Bible says, you see, God does exceedingly abundantly. So when I walk around, that's why I always say I don't have time for junk or foolishness. You are thinking about, oh, the last time this person said this. Oh, did she just pass me? And you say with some emphasis, did she just pass me? Did he just do that? And your mind is all what? Engaged. Did he just do that? Then you are walking around. Some people. And then for the next 5, 10, 15, 30 minutes, this person has captured you. What they said, what they did, has captured you. You see, this law principle works in reverse. Because that's where the devil wants you to be. And then he's going to magnify. Because whatever God does, the devil counterfeits. The devil's is negative, God's is what? Positive. So God will magnify, go beyond. Like Solomon, typical example. He asked for what? An understanding heart to lead the people of God. God went exceedingly abundantly. He gave him that and he blessed him what? Riches. You know what I'm saying? So God will always go higher, do more than you ask. But I want you to be so disciplined that when you walk around, sometimes that's what I'm saying. I've told you over and over. I said, when I breathe in and breathe out, every breath is like a prayer unto God. I'm saying thank you. I cannot say thank you if I'm not focused on his goodness, his love, his covering over my life, the wars he fights on my behalf that I'm not even aware of, victories that he gives me, blessings from the left and from the right, from the center and all over me. You understand what I'm saying? It takes awareness of that, the imagination of things that you are believing God to do and you are seeing them happening. And you go into what? Thanksgiving. So you are walking. You may not say a word, but you are in prayer. And God is answering those things. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You believe God for a job? See yourself with a job. Don't walk around and speak like everybody speaks. Those who are not with God. Those who are not aligned, their minds are not renewed. They say, I hope they call me. I hope they call me. You know, I interviewed, but this is the second one. The first one, they said they will call me. They didn't call me. So this one too, you are saying it. You know, you can tell that there's no hope. But you are saying, I hope they call me. The Bible says, you know, when you go for it, just know that it is done. It's a done deal. He went ahead of you. So I have this job. Then you are expecting the call. You understand what I'm saying? You are expecting the call. But then say, how do you call me?
God, amen.
Thank you. You possess it. You know?
Amen.
But then I say, okay, I'm just going to, you know what? I saw this answer, so I'm going to go there just in case these people, they don't call me. You mess it up. You don't have faith. You have faith, but you're not exercising it. Be supernatural.
Amen.
Because he guides you into truth. So you will know and you stay put. Amen. And be thanking him that you have this job. Yeah. They don't say, let me secure this. Just in case. You understand what I'm saying? Just in case. This, they don't call me. You know, then. No. You're all over the place. Double-mindedness. You can't receive anything from God. Be still and know that he's God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So let your mind be full of. The Bible says, you keep in perfect peace the one whose mind is stayed on thee. That is Isaiah 26:3. So when your mind is stayed on the things of God, it's like you're walking around, but you know, the angels go to work. Do you get what I'm saying? That's how they respond to the desires of God, the will of God, the work of God, the ways of God. The angels, they work where the word of God is present. So it's working for you. Don't walk around thinking, oh, this thing I know. Every year around this season, I know my allergy. You claim it already, you said my allergy. Mm-hmm. Well, every year around this season, my allergy. Mm-hmm. You guys, you don't know. The way it is, da-da-da-da-da. And so around the corner, the time is opening up, but you're expecting it. You got what I'm saying? And we've done some of these things for years. You claim it. You know, for years. Now, I'm not saying that there's nothing, something wrong with being proactive. Somebody will say, okay, then why do you have insurance? If you believe no car is going to hit you and all that, blah, blah, blah. So we have to know how we balance these things with with our brains, with the natural.
That's right.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah. There's difference. Some people say, okay, why do you have first aid? If you don't believe this, why do you have first aid? No. Then you are being foolish. You get what I'm saying? Don't throw away your brains. Hallelujah. But don't be expecting. I'll tell you the difference. I don't know if I can go live saying what I'm going to say. Okay, in a place where there's so much robbery, at times, you may be driving, somebody can stop you. And at times they use motorbikes. So somebody, there may be two on the bike, they will just pull up, and then right away, they'll grab you, pull the knife on you and stuff like that. And it's been rampant. So it got to a time, somebody seeing this, the person now has wired his thinking. He's walking around always thinking that he's going to be attacked. He's going to be attacked. So he's also prepared himself the way when he is attacked, what he's going to do. To the point that when he's driving, he says he puts his phone in his pocket and his house key, he puts it in his pocket. And then he has a decoy, if I'm saying it right, another phone, he leaves it in the car. So when somebody stops them and right away, like a robber, thief, whatever, I say, get out. You think that that's my phone, but that's not my phone. I have my key, my house key in my pocket, and I have my phone in my pocket, and then, well, I can leave the car. My life is intact. I leave. And look at this. Look at this kind of lifestyle. And it's been this way for years. But I know that some of these things have been with us. I mean, all over the world. I've seen some of these things myself. I've seen pickpockets. The way when you walk, they will try to grab your wallet, purse. You know, they will pull something out of your pocket and all. I've seen all those things live. But that doesn't mean that you walk around and expecting that, oh, today is the day that they are going to take my wallet away. You don't walk like that. You have to say that, you know, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord is my shield. He's my protector. He's watching over me. So nothing like this will happen to me. I'll give you a similar thing. When the COVID broke out, COVID-19, some people were expecting to be what? To be what? Hit, as it were. To be infected with a virus. I went into stores to start with. I wasn't wearing masks. And I didn't want to wear it. It became a mandate. I'm not saying don't wear a mask. Please wear a mask. That's me. I walked in the stores. I wasn't afraid of people. I wasn't wearing it. People were wearing it. So somebody see and then move away. You know, I wasn't wearing it. And I wasn't expecting that somebody who is infected will infect me or affect me or whatever. I didn't think that way. I told you, I shared it over here. I said, look, I'm light. Coronavirus is darkness. Light has no fellowship with darkness. But people who walk around, I don't want to get this thing. This thing, the way it is, if you want to get it. And I talked to people, and some of the way they said they are scared. I'm talking about believers. They spoke to me. I know what I'm talking about. And some never, ever, they just started going to church. But some never, ever participated in any church service. That was how much afraid they were. Do you get what I'm saying? So at times our expectation is wrong. When you expect, you are attracting it. You are asking for it. You are welcoming. You are claiming it. You are possessing it. Possess the promise of God.
Amen.
Claim the promise of God. Expect the promise of God. Accept the promise of God. That's what you do.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I walked around. Nothing happened to me. And that's what I'm talking about. You see, at times, somebody say, oh, you are different. It's all about renewing your mind with the word of God.
Amen.
And I told these stories. When we were going to change, the year 2000 was going to roll in. They said computers are going to crash. You can't even get money from your own bank. Your own money, your ATM cards will not work. This will not work. You know, there will be shortage of this and shortage of that. That time, Nathan was not even born. Now he's 20 years. Wow. And people were rushing for water and all that. And I told the church, We're in Stafford, not Manchester here. I said, look, don't go out there and follow this crazy thing that everybody's running around. I know that I know by the witness of the Holy Spirit, what God has told me, nothing of that nature is going to happen. And I'm not getting any, even 1 gallon of water, 1 gallon of milk, just in case. I'm not taking money out just in case. And I did it. I did it. And nothing happened. You know what I'm saying? So at times, it's about what voice you are listening to. What voice you are listening to. What voice you are hearing. That makes a lot of difference. But when you walk with him and come to a place of maturity, some appreciable level, look, the noise around you, there will be noise, but you don't hear. In the book of Exodus chapter 32, there was something, a similar thing. Joshua was telling Moses, I hear noise in the camp. And it's like these people, they are under siege and war going on. He said, it's not the noise of battle or war that I hear. But what? He said, the noise of merrymaking. He was able to tell. Hallelujah.
Amen.
A major thing. The same thing happened when this coronavirus thing. And everybody would say, grab this, grab that, grab this. Pastor Joseph was telling me, somebody, they spent as much as $2,000 of their car to store things, to buy things and store them. Because they realized that there will be a moment, your toilet paper, you won't have it. So what do you think about it? Oh, so now when I use the toilet, what do I do? Then that will drive you crazy. Hey, let me run here and get this. You see, what voice are you listening to? We didn't store up anything. And some of you were here. I kept telling you the same thing. Don't be foolish. Listen to the Holy Spirit within you.
Amen.
I've lived this way for years. So I've tried it. It's tested. It's proven. And Romans, the book of Romans says something. Let's go there. Romans 5:5. I'll close on that note. Hallelujah to Jesus.
Amen.
When you get one experience and another experience, that's it. Nobody can stop you. It says this, now hope, that's not what? Come on, let's do it together. We are going to close and go home and enjoy our meals. Now hope, that's not what? This is the point. Because the love of God has been what? Poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Let's continue. Hallelujah to Jesus. For when we were still without strength, due time, what? Christ died for the ungodly. Let's go on. For scarcely
for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die.
Alright. What I'm looking for, I don't know if it's still here. Let's see the 8th verse. If it's not there, no, for the love of God, no. Okay, let's see verse 4. Yes, this is what I was looking for. Let's back up to 3. Verse 3. Let's read together. Read. We are in Romans 5:3. Read. And not only that, but we also what? Glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces what? Perseverance. Read on. And perseverance, character. And character, character, character. You see what I'm talking about? Character. So when I talk the way I talk, that's why I talk the way I talk. So when you have followed the word voice of God, and you see result after result, and you do it time and time again, over and over again, it becomes part and parcel of you. It becomes your character. It becomes a habit. You know what I'm saying? It becomes a character. It becomes a habit. And nothing can change you. And that's why I keep telling you, I'm always relaxed. It doesn't matter what I hear. I'm always relaxed. It doesn't matter what goes on. I'm always relaxed. Like someone who say, God got this. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yes. So go for that experience. Exercise your faith. And when you have it, it's like, You can't tell me otherwise. It's too late. Amen. I know it for myself. Amen. It's not like somebody told me. Yeah. I have experienced it.
Amen.
Now, let's see what Amplified Version says from verse 3. Let's read together. Read. Moreover, let us one also be full of what? Joy now. Be full of what now?
Joy.
Now. Joy. Now. Joy. Not sometime. Now. Let us one exalt and triumph in our what? Troubles. It doesn't say let us what? Sorrow. Let us triumph in our troubles and rejoice in our sufferings. You see the attitude? This is it. Continue. Knowing that pressure. No. We didn't finish that. Knowing. Read. Knowing that pressure and affliction and hardship produce what? Patience. And unwavering what? Endurance. You have a backbone. Okay. Next verse. Moreover, is that where we are? And endurance. What? Fortitude. Develops what? Maturity of character. Do you see that? So people who run away from problems, they don't handle their problems well. Instead of going with the leading of the Holy Spirit, the voice of God, the word of God, truth, they choose otherwise, you are what? Doing justice to yourself because you never mature. That's why we have a lot of people in the system, Christians, they don't mature. Because one word, phrase, I'll say sentence that most people use. You know, the word of God is true, but you have to use wisdom. You have to use wisdom. And you have said this for years. You have to use wisdom. And the wisdom you're using is crooked. It's not godly wisdom. It's not wisdom from above. You're not going anywhere. You have to use the wisdom that is from above. And then that will bring you into this maturity. Your fear, you won't even experience fear anymore. If fear shows up on your door, you won't feel it. But when you feel it, it will not even dominate you. Because you have this discipline, maturity of character. Approved word, faith. Tried integrity. A character of this word, salt, produces the habit of joyful and confident hope of eternal salvation. That's what I'm talking about. You walk in confidence. There's no day that your confidence, moment that your confidence will be shattered. Some people, their confidence is in what they are wearing. So if they are not wearing that, they don't feel confident. You know? They have to wear something and then they feel confident. Am I saying it right?
Yeah.
They have to drive a certain car so they feel confident. They have to have a certain diploma on their wall so they feel confident. No. Your confidence to be in the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So when you are even naked without your clothes, when you are not sleeping in that house, in that bed, when you are not driving that car, you still you are what?
Confident.
Amen. Maturity of character. That's my title for today. Maturity of character. And I'll end with these words in Galatians chapter 5, verses 1 and 13. Stand firm in the liberty wherewith Jesus, the anointed, has made you free. And do not be again entangled with the yoke of bondage, but by love serve one another. Amen. Hallelujah! Amen. Come on, let's say it. Hallelujah!